laws the Irish government passed don't in any way affect you, so I mean, in what way are you Irish?
Because I live in Northern Ireland.
Irish, you keep associating with the Republic. It was part of Ireland, this Northern Ireland.
In general, in Northern Ireland.
Yes.
The nationalists want to become part of Ireland.
Yes.
And the Protestants want to stay part of the United Kingdom.
Not all Protestants.
You're writing off all Protestants as Ulster Unionists by saying that. We all want this total separation from Ireland. Some of us do, some of us don't.
I want to be a star.
Every man worth his salt should be proud of the achievements of his ancestors, no matter what class or creed he may belong to.
Anything to do with history, we never celebrate it in the true sense of the word. It's always really like a protest from one side on the other. There's a point up. For instance, the March there, it's going to be held on Saturday. It's more like a protest, sort of the Protestants against the Catholics. We're a point up anew, sort of thing.
Let's face it, there are two distinct cultures in Northern Ireland. Two traditions with separate identities, and we would maintain the right to promote and celebrate part of our heritage. And in doing that, of course, we don't again mean to give any offence, but you know, what are we to do to give up all the heritage and culture over the past 400 years of the Ulster British culture and simply cave in? We're not prepared to do that. We have given up quite a lot of roots in the past in order to not to offend the nationalist population, and we feel we've gone as far as we can in that direction.
It was a completely Protestant thing, and I felt that if any Catholic had been there, it'd been mauled to death. The Catholics would have been scared to go in there that day.
Do you think certain Protestants might have as well?
I just think that they wouldn't want to be involved, you know. And
how representative do you feel it is of Protestantism? Would it represent a majority of Protestant feeling as you see it, or a minority?
Almost a minority. Well, a minority maybe.
Present generation, if they do not honour the noble deeds of their ancestors or their forefathers, then they in turn will not be honoured by succeeding generations.
I would hate to think that maybe by the time I'm 40 or something, I'll be a hardened old woman sitting in her house vegetating, you know, with maybe three kids and teaching them all to be hardline loyalists because we want to stay British.
I'd say the majority of people I know don't want any contact at all with Catholics. I don't see them wanting any in the future as well.
Why not, Timothy?
Well, most of the people I know have been brought up in their troubles. And they've brought up, they believe and hate the Catholics.
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our...
And I'd never been to a mass before, so I was sort of fascinated by the ritual of it. The wiping of the cup and the folding and the altar boy.
It's a very beautiful church, but it's always almost as if it's at play. You know, you don't really feel part of it. You know, you're just sort of sitting and looking, and it's all so demonstrative, and they're so detached. They're like players on a stage, nearly. Presbyterians are just sort of very standard, you know, white walls, cream walls, just, that's it. Maybe one stained glass window in the whole place. But this is just so wonderful. It's really beautiful.
I thought it was all very false. Well, from my point of view anyway, compared to what I'm used to. So, Lamb of God this and Lamb of God that. But the place is very, very ornamental. And the statues, they're all plaster statues. Don't like them at all.
Well, I think it, within the Presbyterian, isn't there, really, it's a... It promotes you as an individual. You can think for yourself more. In this Catholicism, it seems to be stick to a set pattern. And the way that people are rhyming things off, maybe that's part of Catholicism. That, well, it must be the decoration and the beauty of the buildings. And there's an attraction in the ceremony.
I think the service here today, I mean, we all stood out, as obviously we weren't part of what was going on, you know. I think if you go to a Protestant service, you went to a Presbyterian service, you know, you don't stand out. You know, if a Roman Catholic went to, say, a Presbyterian church, you know, nothing that went on would make them stand out as something different from everybody else, whereas here we were labelled as obviously not part of what was going on.
Well, I mean, I believe... I don't say that I'm a very religious person, but I certainly believe that there is a God. And that's basically it.
Go to church on a Sunday. Believe in God. Not religious, but Presbyterian.
No, well, I mean, I think to be a Protestant, you have to believe, you have to be religious. I mean, it is a religious label. I mean, I'm not in no way religious, so I don't see myself as a Protestant. There is a long tradition of, you know, Protestantism means a certain political belief, but it doesn't to me. I mean, I have a political belief, but it's not influenced by my religion. You know, if my parents were Zen Buddhists, I would still be a Unionist, you know.
Right, get him on out now. That's us. That's it.
Keep him up
off
the ground.
Yes.
Put him on
the
scaffold.
Right.
Swing around. The Protestant community are being pushed back into a corner from all sides, and they're going to have to fight their way back out of it the way they did in 1689. Not actually physical fighting, but more protesting at what they're doing to us. And show them in that way that we don't want to be pushed back in the corner, and that we won 300 years ago, so to speak, and that we can do it again.
Jim, take them to one side here, right? Right? We left them this side, one side.
Right. I feel it's important to remember the history of the city, and also a father and uncles are in the apprentice boys. I just like to follow family tradition, but it's more so because I wanted to remember the history of the city by marching in the street to show what I felt. It was important that there was a siege to change the name to Londonderry and make sure that Northern Ireland stayed British, that there's just the way I would like to follow my life through the Protestant tradition as it has been for the past around 200 years.
I think that's what's happened. That's why the situation is today, because the Unionists have clung on to a nationality that really doesn't fit in the context that we live in, that they were living in Ireland, and if everything had went well, if they all had integrated into the Irish society and they sort of got on with the people there, if they hadn't taken the land, then life would have been a bit better, but the problems would have decreased if they'd bit of give and take on both sides, which they hadn't. If you totally did away with England, I think they would have come together and the problems would have been ironed out.
We had a discussion with a Catholic boy one weekend. We were away and at that time we didn't even know the difference between a Republican and a Nationalist. And he explained to us, and we were very sketchy about the civil rights marches and things like that, and he filled us all in, and he was the same age as us. And so he was much more politically aware than us. Then the Catholics have more of a cause to fight for. We haven't really got a cause like they have, like the Nationalist cause or the Republican cause.
I just feel that Britain has given up on us, on Northern Ireland. They just want to get rid of us as easily as they can. They're letting us down.
Well, they're starting to last a dignity, I find. The unions really don't have anybody to look to now.
Northern Ireland still looks to Britain for its leadership. So,
Britain isn't doing anything for you.
I know. Well, I don't think I would have faith in the Conservatives for as long as the Protestants still hold the majority in North Ireland, but after that I don't know. And I wouldn't like to start thinking what it would be like if there was a United Ireland, because I think you'd probably have the situation in Northern Ireland in reverse, probably a lot stronger, because you'd find the Protestants then come together. They fight against well, you can crudely put it, as a common enemy.
It's very much a fear of change, a fear of sort of the unknown, and fear of giving up what you hold dear, you know. Well, fear of giving too much power to the Catholics, that they in turn would gain power, and that would be to the detriment, as they saw it, of Ireland. I mean, the same with the Stormont administration, where, you know, if you give too much, then, you know, power shifts from a mainly Protestant base to mainly Catholic base, and that was the fear of the Stormont administration.
Since those civil rights marches, I think it's made all the difference. But I don't think they're trapped as much in the history of 300 years ago as the history 20 years ago. What happened in those civil rights marches and what's happened since then, you know, all these shootings, I think that's what's got people's feelings up. I just see that as a turning point.
I don't see why we should feel part of Ireland. That's because maybe
why can't
do.
You do both?
Ireland, not the island. You know, the whole island. Ireland. Not the Republic of Ireland or Northern Ireland. Ireland, you know. You did geography in third year, didn't you? Maybe.
I mean, maybe it's a definite.
Well, this is definitely a constitution.
Scotland is over the English border.
What?
Scottish soil is British soil.
I think she's right, Jonathan.
Oh, no.
Our argument has been dashed.
break out the guns.
You know, we were going down in the train, you know, it was still a bit sleepy-eyed. But, you know, your mind's going round, you're thinking, you know, what's it going to be like, or what are we going to do, or what are we going to see, and, you know, is it going to be full of villains and thieves, you know, is it going to be dirty, is it going to be smog everywhere?
My parents don't think they're my opinion. He'll put rosary beads round my throat. And our honeymoon tour is a wee stop at Lourdes. Then we're going for tea with the Pope. Yes, our honeymoon tour is a wee stop at Lourdes.
They tend to take a position their buddy takes or their mate takes, and all join in. You know, they're all sat in the one group, you notice. And there always seems to be a sort of leader. We'll take his point of view. Maybe if he had each one of them individually, he would find their views weren't just so rock solid. Loyalist.
Maybe they disagree among themselves, but when faced with something, they always pull together and have a solid front. They're not prepared to let other people see that they are fractioning inside you. Questioning things.
We are approaching Draw the Station. Draw the Station, our next stop. Thank you.
And I'm getting out and staying out. I don't want any of that. I'm fed up with it. I've just had it in my back teeth. I'm sick of all the fighting and the stupidity and the pig-headedness of everybody. I don't want anything more to do with it. I've had it.
I don't know, personally, I don't want to leave. I'd like to stay here. I mean, no. It was a class of ours, and the teacher asked, you know, who, in the future, who would like to leave Northern Ireland. You know, there was about a class of 20 people, I think about 18 people put up their hands. You know, me and somebody else didn't put up their hands. It was that sort of thing.
I would like to stay here, but if there's no opportunities open to me, I'll be going. Yeah. I like country, and that is my country, and I don't want to leave it, but if I have to, I'll go.
Starting us off, Patricia, at 7.
Good morning. The cross-border rail link is again at the centre of a bomb scare. A suspect device has been spotted lying on the tracks about 100 yards on this side of the frontier. The device was discovered at 4:30 this morning, and the security forces called in. St. Patrick's Day parades are expected to go
ahead. I'm sure we'll bomb on a sinking ship, aren't we? This is a lost cause and we clear off.
Jonathan, does it not give you a certain sense of pride that in the House of Lords and the capital of Ireland, two historical events are commemorated in these tapestries, and one from your native city?
Well, I would prefer it if they were on the north, not here, because I think that's where they should be. Seeing the Ireland as two separate countries, I think they should be returned to where they do what is regarded as their home.
The way the boys are going on, it's almost as if
They have a copyright over that, the Siege of Derry.
I think it should stay here.
It was made for here, and it has hung here for 200 years. Why should it be moved now?
I'm disappointed that it is in Dublin. I'd rather see it in our city.
I think, the same as David, it should be up in Londonderry.
What do you think motivates people to say that?
I don't know. I need to ask them.
Here it can be appreciated as a work of art as well as a historical statement that it makes, whereas back home people would just see the political statement that it makes and just see it as a statement against the Catholics, as a defeat over them.
Well, it's not a matter of division and history and heritage. It's a matter that everyday Protestants can't go to their normal jobs without being murdered by people who claim to represent Ireland. And that's the main thing that divides the two communities.
Half of us are saying that these tapestries should be left here, and half of us are saying that they should be up in Londonderry. We can't even be as one in our belief of where a mere trivial thing as tapestries should be, so how can we be together about communities?
There is no British culture. Being British is just a stamped label you're given. But you need a culture, you need an identity to feel secure, to feel you're part of community, to feel you're settled in a community, which is the problem I think a lot of Protestants have. All they can stamp themselves with is we're British. But that's not enough. You need a culture as well.
You seem to be supporting the Republican cause.
You're backing them.
We're backing the ordinary people who live down there.
How many people are in Port Leash jail, serving sentences as a result of their crimes and terrorist action? They're not Irish people. Look at Dundalk. That's a Republican stronghold. That's.
Of course. We're talking about Dublin, we're not talking about Dundalk.
Dundalk, Dublin, it's all the same to me. Just.
Down south, 150 miles away from the trouble over the border, it's just alien to them. They don't go around, it's just something up the other end of the country. They're not totally involved and see this on their television as much as we do, and we read about it and involved in it. They don't hear bombs and all the rest of it that we would.
Well, they just come up the north and plant their
Therefore,
bombs.
Therefore, I think...
They just go up the north and plant their bombs and come back south.
Being Irish is not, in fact, a dirty word, you know? You can be a Protestant and be Irish, you know?
I think over the past couple of hundred years,
you've basically had the terms Irish associated with being Catholic, you know? Which is basically like being a Catholic and being a Republican, you know? It all stems from 1798 and what have you, you know?
There's a large amount of people in the Irish Republic that support the IRA.
There's a large amount of people in the Irish Republic that don't support the IRA.
You are pretending as if there's no violence or nothing in Northern Ireland. Terrorism, as I see it, is that people go out and murder because they enjoy it. It's not for any cause at all. Because they enjoy killing people.
If you kill somebody, you're not a patriot, you're a murderer, and that's as simple as
it. It just turns them on or something. They get a buzz. Like, it's not funny at all. And I don't like people laughing about it, because it's a very serious matter. Well, that's not to be taken lightly.
Are we laughing?
You were laughing there a while ago.
I don't know where you think this argument is going. What we're arguing here is that there is patriotism on both sides. There are Irish patriots. I mean, I admire patriotism on anybody's side, and that is where the difference of opinion lies. Now, this is my country, and that's what I'm prepared to fight for.
nowadays, because of the last 20 years, everything's been separated totally, and the Protestants don't look towards Ireland as you know, the true culture of Ireland as theirs. I think that's sad, because, like, there's good parts of it, and why can't you keep them?
And kick ye from here till Ardoin. That horse is a filly, and the rider's King Billy, and the river is known as the Boyne.
Well, that was ignorance. More than anything else. It was just plain ignorance. Which was my own fault. And I'm sorry, you know. But I look back with regret now in that.
Then we're going for tea with the poor.
Was I like that, or did I do that, or how did people see me? Because I don't think I was like that. You know, and if I was like that, I've changed.
Well, obviously a school like ours would be sad that so many of our good pupils are leaving us never to return. But I think the sadness is within Northern Ireland. Many of them do feel that there's very little for them here, politically and economically. They don't see any particular hope in the future. They've been seeing the same things being said, basically, by politicians. There's the odd glimmer of hope. But yet, whenever there's any, where there's too great movement, that glimmer of hope seems to disappear. So it's very understandable, really, that they view it pessimistically.
Politics in Northern Ireland's dead. It's been the same thing happening now for the last 20 years.
How can you say people have learned what's going on for 20 years?
I would call myself moderate. I don't see anybody that's speaking for me.
It's quite easy to see unionist politics as being rather intransigent and not going anywhere.
Stationary. Stuck in the mud.
Destructive politics, you know. Also says no.
You want to be able to do what you want, talk to whoever you want, and sort of, you know, live your life without having all these barriers.
The blue, white, and red.
Political division.
Who's who? Green, white, and orange.
Hypocrisy.
Politics.
Stereotype.
Politics.
When I go away, it'll take a hell of a lot to bring me back.
Religion's never mentioned here, of course. You know them by their eyes and hold your tongue. One side's as bad as the other, never worse. Christ, it's near time that some small leak was sprung. The famous Northern reticence, the tight gag of place and times, yes, yes, of the wee six I sing, where to be saved you only must save face, and whatever you say nothing.
I don't want to emigrate, I don't want to go and live in England, I'd rather live here. Even if the troubles still continue, I'd still rather live here than in England. I'm going to miss your family, your friends, the band, I just miss the city itself, even though at times you might find it depressing and very pessimistic. You still miss it when you go.
Well, I'm very apprehensive about it. I'll just see how it goes and hope I can get on with them okay. You know, I'll get slagged off quite a bit, I'm sure. But we'll weather the storm for a few months and see how it goes. Yeah, I don't care what they say. or how people stamp me. At the end of the day, I'm an individual. I don't adopt any identity. Free person of the world, you know.
In their ways, and nobody wants to change, so one answer is just to leave. It's a tempting way of not trying here.
Everything's just far too divided. There's just no opportunity to mix. There's very few places where people do mix, can mix, and are mixed in this town. You've got an older generation in charge, and they remember the good old, bad old days, you know, where people were out and riding and throwing stones and whatever. But the my generation coming up, I think there's a lot more sensible people. And hopefully, if they don't all go away like me, that might change through.
Ulster says no. And obviously, being a more moderate Protestant, I would like to suggest that Ulster says yes, you know.
Yeah, a pot of paint and a brush and decided they were going to dub the slogan on. I mean, like, the slogans are pointless and futile because people have been painting, you know, like, painting slogans for 20-odd years and probably before. And what bloody good has it done them?
It's a box society. I mean, everywhere's bound to have their own boxes and restraints, and maybe it's difficult to see what the restraints in England might be from here because we're just fighting to get out of ours, but maybe we're not thinking about what we're going to be getting ourselves into when we get over there as well.
Great escape that would take you accelerating beyond the roadblocks and ramps and folk memory ramparts and curfews and intermittent internments and peace walls and Derry's walls and no surrendering and no going here and no going there and no going any f***ing where, not ever. Accelerating beyond the segregated schooling and sectarianism in the workplace and one door closing while another shut in your face. Foot to the board, accelerating and accelerating and accelerating until, boom, you broke free altogether.
Oh, it was terrible. I just thought, oh, I don't want to be here. With loads of traffic around and loads of pollution and fumes and loads of people going around their business, like really busy, typical London. I just thought, no. I just wanted to cry and just get phone my dad and say, come and get me, I want to go home. I just thought, oh, it's the most awful place to come to. And everyone knew where they were going and knew what they were doing, and I didn't. I hadn't a clue. I was sitting with my head aside, and I didn't even know which bus to get on, or didn't know how to get on a tube. I just thought, oh, it's the most threatening place. Like, why did I come here? And I really regretted coming, and I thought, I've made the wrong decision. Because all I could think about was, I know no one, and there's no one cares, because I'm stuck away over here, and everyone is miles away at home.
I
I've tried basically to assemble what I had before I came here, but for the first month, I would imagine, I was just shell-shocked, the change. Because there's no getting away from it. You can't jump on a motorbike and speed off to the Donegal Hills or the countryside. It's just all built up.
Now the fact that I've stayed and all the Protestant friends have mainly gone away, I'm starting to know a lot more Catholic people and talking to them and, you know, meeting them in the street and stopping and talking to them, perhaps a way I wouldn't have done before. I feel more free and more sort of able. I mean, like, I go and visit people in the Craigan and places like that, places I wouldn't have gone before. Like, I was never in the Craigan until I was, 17? And now, I mean, I'm not saying that I'm in there on a regular basis, but I have friends up there who can go and sit and chat with and whatever. Why should I be particularly worried about going into the Craigan or going to the Bogside or going anywhere? You know, I haven't done anything in anybody. You know, before I didn't have a particular reason to go in there. Now I do. I'm going in to see a friend and have a chat with them, a cup of tea or whatever, or pick them up and take them out, you know, for the evening. That's just a natural thing to do. People don't realise how similar they all are. I mean, they're all in the same area and they all have the same problems, basically, because they are in the same area and they've got the same, they should have the same basic worries. I mean, like, about whether the bins are being collected or whether the roads are being mended or the streetlights are being put up or whatever, but they don't. They seem to be totally preoccupied with this whole idealistic Northern Ireland, but which is a complete and utter waste of time, in my opinion.
Now I've settled in, but it's been a long time. It's taken a long while to settle in, and I'm quite happy here now. It's so different from home, whereas Northern Ireland is quite a very white, middle-class society compared to here. And I think that's one of the advantages of London. You meet so many different people from all over the world, and I have friends who are Muslim or Sikh, and now I'm getting to know more about what they believe. So yeah, definitely broadens your horizons. You see how narrow you are in Northern Ireland, just fighting among Protestants and Catholics. It's really silly.
Just because I'm over here, I'm not going to change my views and opinions in Northern Ireland. I've always stood by these now for a couple of years. I'm not going to change it now. Some people, they ask you about it, and then you get others telling you about it. I don't mind people asking me about it, try to give them an unbiased view of things, but some people from that have never been to Northern Ireland tell you about the situation there. You sort of, you know, you don't like them enough because they know nothing about it. They think it doesn't affect their lives, the troubles in Northern Ireland, the English people, so they just don't care about it.
Have you been homesick since you've been away? You've been away now for 3 months.
Homesick for the first month or two. It was more to do with the fact where I was staying. London, in a word. But this is the student environment. This is where everybody fits in.
You think you'll fit in quite comfortably here in Cambridge?
Of course, why shouldn't I?
I still drink in the same bar that I've always drunk in. I still hang about with the same people. Maybe they might not like the way that I've changed or my sort of more liberal opinions, but I still get on with those people. They're still my friends. I can still go out for a drink with. Those things that I might be left out of, perhaps it's just as well that I am, I don't.
you've got to have something to hold on to say this is me, and the people aren't going to change me just because of where I am. When you're homesick, whatever identity you had, or if you didn't think you had one, you're going to assume some sort of identity. You're much more aware of it when you're away from home, of course. You find yourself in a pub and you get up and declare yourself as being Irish, I suppose.
You're half Irish and then you're half not, which is, I think, the problem with Northern Ireland. Because, yeah, I'm from Ireland, yeah, I've got an Irish accent. Yeah, I really miss home sometimes, and when the Irish Society play different songs and stuff, and when RTE on a Wednesday night, they do a link-up, and they play, you know, Daniel O'Donnell and all the really... all the things that you wouldn't listen to at home, but here they remind you of home.
But people here don't have an idea. They don't distinguish between North and South in Ireland. If you're Irish, you're Irish. Whether you come from Belfast or Cork, they wouldn't know the difference.
And I think I feel more Irish than I did at home, because everybody keeps slagging me about my Irish accent, and that it's really funny. And I'm quite aware of it when I speak in front of other people.
You begin to feel so comfortable in normal surroundings, normal life, away from the terrorist situation. It becomes very distant to you. Your local bobby, instead of your army foot patrol. I found it very strange coming into work and we have an 11 o'clock break or whatever, and you get to sit and watch the news, and the next thing you see a £400 bomb has gone off in Londonderry, and you're amazed. You just point at the TV and go, well, that's where I live, and everybody's astonished. Is that what you love? They've a different line of thought here completely as regards religion. You can't even start to explain how a Protestant feels.
At home you're always taught that you have a link with Britain rather than Southern Ireland. You're Protestant and you're with Britain, like keep Ulster British. Whereas it doesn't work, because you're totally different. And I think that's what people in Ulster need to realise, that you have more in common with people from Southern Ireland rather than England.
I would call myself British to start with. I wouldn't say I'm Northern Irish, I'm British, so I'm... You're just loyal to your friends who you are and what you've believed in. That's what you're doing. Not clinging on to anything, it's just something you believe in.
The chair squeaks in a high wind. Rain falls from its branches. The kettle yearns for the mountain, the soap for the sea. In the tiny stone church on the desolate headland, a lost tribe is singing, "Abide with me."
I could make a place in the society if I wanted one, same way as anybody could, but I don't want one. Countries for nothing. The economy is a way to hell. The divisions here are cause problems which don't occur in very many other places, and I don't want that problem. And being a Protestant, I'm automatically branded as being this, that, or the other, and I don't want that.
When you do meet new people, Yvonne may have found that, although they won't directly say, are you Catholic or are you Protestant, because, I mean, a lot of people aren't that interested, but you do get a lot of people to say, what school do you go to? And everyone knows what school means, whether it's a Catholic or a Protestant.
Smoke signals are loudmouthed compared with us. Maneuverings to find out name and school. Subtle discrimination by addresses, with hardly an exception to the rule. That Norman, Ken and Sydney signal prod, And Seamus called me Sean with surefire pip. O land of password, hand grip, wink and nod, of open minds as open as a trap.